Dr. Ted Venema Talks Audiology, the educational whiteboard series brought to you by Next Gen Hearing.
Hi, I'm Ted Venema, here to talk to you about the tympanogram and tympanometry. Tympanometry is a fast, non-behavioral test of the middle ear. It rapidly and quickly tells you the status of the patient's middle ear function without any voluntary compliance on the part of the patient. The normal middle ear, the main assumption behind tympanometry is that the normal middle ear has air pressure that's even on both sides of the tympanic membrane. This is a key underlying assumption to understanding the principles behind tympanometry. When the air pressure is even-steven on both sides of the eardrum, the middle ear is most efficient at passing sounds through it. Again, when the air pressure is even on both sides of the eardrum, that's what you want. That makes the middle ear most efficient at passing sounds through it. When the air pressure is uneven on both sides, Houston, we've got a problem, and this yields a conductive hearing loss. Tympanometry, unlike pneumatic otoscopy, which assesses how much the eardrum actually wiggles or moves with air pressure, tympanometry is different. Tympanometry tests how much sound bounces back off the tympanic membrane as a function of air pressure changes in the outer ear canal. Again, in the outer ear canal, air pressure changes are made, and the clinician is examining how much sound is bouncing back off the eardrum as the air pressure is changed from positive to room air pressure to negative. A normal finding with tympanometry is that the least amount of sound is bouncing back off the drum at normal room air pressure in a closed and sealed ear canal. Again, when most sound is going through the drum, least is bouncing back off the drum. And if you make the air pressure positive to room air pressure to negative air pressure in the ear canal, while you're doing that air pressure change, when least amount of sound bounces back off the drum, you hope that's the case at normal room air pressure. You know why? Because then you'll realize that the air pressure on the inside of the in the middle ear space, the medial side of the eardrum, that air pressure is also room air pressure. Remember, we go right back to this fundamental underlying principle. The middle ear is most efficient at passing sounds when air pressure is even on both sides of the tympanic membrane. Let's look at figure one, because figure one shows you the probe tube assembly used in tympanometry to yield a tympanogram. You'll see that this probe tube is put into the patient's outer ear canal, and it's got to render an airtight seal. Once an airtight seal is obtained, you can progress through the stages of your tympanogram. Now, you'll note in the probe that there's three holes. One hole is a tiny speaker, and this speaker presents a tone at a constant decibel level, a fixed decibel level. The tone is constantly coming out. You'll notice a second hole is a microphone, which is picking up any sound bouncing back off the drum. The third hole is a hole whereby air pressure can be changed from positive air pressure to room air pressure to negative air pressure. In this way, we check how much sound is bouncing off the drum as a function of air pressure changes. Now, when we look at figure two, this figure will show you the actual tent-shaped tympanogram. Let's look at the axes closely here. The horizontal axis is air pressure. It's showing you positive air pressure. The zero in the middle is regular room air pressure, and then you'll see negative air pressure. So the air pressure begins at positive air pressure in the ear canal with the probe tube inserted in the client's or the patient's external auditory meatus, the ear canal, and the air pressure is changed from positive to room to negative, and all the while the constant tone emitted from the probe is sent out. And while the air pressure is being changed, we measure the amount of sound bouncing back off the eardrum. You'll notice the normal tympanogram looks just like a tent. Its peak shows you that the least amount of sound is bouncing off the drum at room air pressure. You see, the vertical axis of a tympanogram shows you the amount of sound bouncing off the drum. The horizontal shows you the air pressure changes. So when the tent-shaped result shows the peak of the pup tent over regular room air pressure in the ear canal, we then can assume that the middle ear space air pressure, that air pressure behind or medial to the tympanic membrane, is the same as the air pressure in the outer ear canal. That's a normal finding. Let's look at figure 3, because this shows you the normal tympanogram and also some abnormal ones. Note again the tympanogram shaped like a tent over regular room zero air pressure. That's called a Jerger type A tympanogram. Jerger, J-E-R-G-E-R, a world-renowned audiologist. Now, the Jerger type A is a normal tympanogram. A Jerger type C is associated with early otitis media. Let's look at it. Look at the type C tympanogram on this figure. See how it too is shaped like a tent, but the peak of the tent is not over the zero. It's over negative air pressure. What this means is we had to make the air pressure in the outer ear canal negative in order to match the negative air pressure found behind the eardrum, because the early otitis media begins with negative air pressure. The eardrum is sucked in medially. And remember the underlying assumption. When the air pressure is made to be even Steven on both sides of the drum, most sound goes through that drum. So with early otitis media having negative air pressure in the middle ear space, we had to make negative air pressure in the ear canal to match that. And now the air pressure is negative on both sides of the drum. That means most sound could get through. So the peak of early otitis media, the type C tympanogram, is found over negative air pressure. When otitis media advances to a fluid-filled middle ear space, advanced otitis media now is associated with what's called a type B tympanogram. And you can see on the diagram how I drew the type C transitioning or changing into a type B. Look at how the third tympanogram is still over negative air pressure, but it has a dull and rounded peak. The middle ear is beginning to fill up with fluid. Now, no amount of air pressure changes in the external auditory meatus can hope to match or fight against or counteract fluid. Air pressure changes are no competition to actual fluid buildup behind the drum. So when there's fluid in the middle ear space and the eardrum is like bulged out, no amount of air pressure is going to change the amount of sound that bounces through that person's eardrum. Therefore, the type B tympanogram is shown as a flat line. And that, once again, is associated with advanced fluid-filled otitis media. So you can see how the tympanogram, an amazingly rapid little test, can be done in a few minutes on each ear. It's non-behavioral. It's used commonly by pediatricians. Audiologists and hearing instrument practitioners are trained to do tympanometry, and especially if there's an air bone gap in audiometry. If you see the video we did on audiometry and reading the audiogram, when air conduction scores or thresholds show a hearing loss and bone conduction thresholds by audiometry don't show a hearing loss, tympanometry is a great test to back up that suspicion that the client may have a conductive hearing loss, because a conductive hearing loss will render abnormal tympanograms. Otosclerosis will render its own unique abnormal tympanogram. Sensory neural hearing loss, however, there's no associated middle ear pathology. So the tympanogram with sensory neural hearing loss will be normal. Thanks for listening. This was a talk on tympanometry. See you next time.